I'm going to introduce tonight's speaker. I'm really excited. He's one of YAF's rock stars and alumni of our foundation. You'll see the future you coming up to stage here soon. I'd like to introduce Jerome Hudson. He's the author of 50 Things They Don't Want You to Know and leads a team of reporters at Breitbart News who specialize in highlighting the vast disconnect between Hollywood and everyday Americans. His work covering the Hollywood elites was featured in the New York Times days after President Donald Trump's election in an article titled, How Conservative Sites Turned Celebrity Despair on Its Heads. Jerome has that article framed in his office for posterity. Jerome first received national notoriety after the publication of his article, The Life of a Young Black Conservative, which it went viral on glennbeck.com. He's been published nationally by National Review, The Atlanta Journal-Constitution, Human Events, and The Daily Caller, to name a few. Jerome has been called a rising star by nationally syndicated talk radio host Dennis Prager, and he's a member of the National Center for Public Policy Research and Project 21's Black Leadership Network, serving as on the organization's National Advisory Council. Jerome has conducted hundreds of radio interviews and has been featured on Fox & Friends' Waters World, 700 Club, and the Eric Metaxas Show, just to name a few. Throughout the years, Jerome has engaged in debates on social media with the likes of Grammy-winning singers John Legend, Marvel movie director Joss Whedon, former MSNBC host and author Torre, and repeatedly called a coon by rapper Talib Kweli. Jerome currently resides in Jacksonville, Florida, with his cat, Oreo. Please join me in giving a warm return welcome to Jerome Hudson.
Good evening. I have to update that resume. I made the awful decision to say yes to my book editor again when he said, do you think you could do the 50 things they don't want you to know about Trump? And I was like, yeah, I could do that. So I also wrote that book. It is an absolute pleasure to be here. This is the event that I circle on my calendar every year because it really does fill me up to come out to speak to this event. I almost didn't make it. You guys don't mind if I vent for just a couple minutes. As Kyle said, I live in Jacksonville, Florida, and I actually left to get here yesterday afternoon, but Pete Buttigieg had other plans. The Washington Post had an article this week. I don't know if you saw it. The headline was, why does it seem like traveling sucks so much? And I was thinking, leave it to the Washington Post to massage some ambiguity in there. No, traveling absolutely sucks. And I know why. It's two words, Pete Buttigieg. No, it's great to be here. YAF means absolutely so much to me. And like I said, looking out at all of your beautiful faces, I know you're in this room because you love your country and you've obviously considered a little bit about your future and your place in it. But I am here to tell you today that you have been lied to. I kind of sound like Morpheus a little bit. No, you've been lied to your whole life. Now, there have been big lies and there have been little lies and some medium-sized lies. Some of the lies recently are a little kooky, like Rachel Levine is a woman. That's a strange one. Maybe a Division II linebacker, a crazier one, CNN, most trusted name in news. They just hit a decade low in ratings, so they can't be that trusted. One of the biggest and most pernicious lies is that racism is an ever-present scourge right here in the United States. And if you're born white, then you're born privileged. And if you're born black, then you're born a perpetual victim. It is an absolutely evil lie. And I would submit that to whatever extent racism has existed in this country, whether it be through policy or otherwise, it is because of the existence of the Democratic Party, which I contend is one of the most evil, dangerous, and destructive institutions that has ever existed on this planet. And I can prove it. by a show of hands, who here knows who the Hollywood actress Alyssa Milano is? Just raise your hands. And for the viewing audience, there are not that many hands being raised right now. Don't feel bad if you don't know who Hollywood actress Alyssa Milano is, because the greatest achievement of her acting career came on a show called Who's the Boss, which started before I was born. And the second greatest achievement of her acting career was a goofy magic show called Charmed, which went into syndication before most of you were born. But Alyssa Milano is a loud Democratic Party supporter. She's very influential on the left in Hollywood with Democrats. And she did a weird thing. In 2020, at the Democratic National Convention, she used her social media megaphone, as she often does, to highlight to her 3.5 million Twitter followers, and I quote, "All of the good things that the Democratic Party has done to make the world a better place," end quote. As soon as I saw that tweet, I knew, as Breitbart News Entertainment editor, that I was gonna be having a good night. You see, Alyssa Milano, in her magically and wildly ridiculous Twitter thread, started highlighting all the good things that the Democratic Party has done in 1920. And, you know, I paid attention in history class. The Democratic Party was founded in the 1820s. And I said, well, I mean, she's a useful idiot, but, I mean, is she really? Now, Cal has informed me that most of you have cell phones. I would like you to take them out of your pockets or purses or whatever, and go with me to the National Democratic Party's website, which you'll find at democrats.org. Democrats.org. I'm gonna do it with you. Oh, look at Kamala and Joe, just sharing a good laugh. So you'll see the tab at the top right. You'll click on that and you'll scroll down. No, I don't wanna give you a donation. You'll see a section that says Our History. There's Barack and Michelle. Oh, look at that. Our History. It reads, "For more than 200 years, our party has led the fight for civil rights." Woo, that's a big lie. The Our History page of the National Democratic Party on its history page starts in 1920, but it was an organization founded in 1820. I'm gonna give you a brief history lesson that unlike the progressive college professors waiting on you at your college campuses will likely not give you. And this lesson won't saddle you a crippling debt. We'll start with an easy one. A majority of Democrats voted against the 13th Amendment, which you all know freed the slaves. Exactly zero Democrats voted for the 14th and 15th Amendment, which granted citizenship and voting rights to black people. The truth is that the Democrat website won't tell you is that Democrats spent over a century fighting against civil rights, not 200 years fighting for them. There was a little something called the 1875 Civil Rights Act. If you've never heard of it, that's okay. Just know that you've probably been failed by your history teachers. The 1875 Civil Rights Act made it a federal crime to discriminate against someone based on race. Now that might sound familiar because that is also what the 1964 Civil Rights Act does, which, thanks to Republicans, passed. You see, the 1875 Civil Rights Act did not last that long because a very democratic and racist Supreme Court struck it down less than a decade after its passage. Speaking of the 1964 Civil Rights Act, the greatest senator from Illinois, Everett Dirksen, take that, Barack, that act would not have passed if it was not for Senator Everett Dirksen, because he was fighting very racist Senate Democrats like Robert Byrd and Al Gore Sr. and William Fulbright, who were trying to kill that act. The Ku Klux Klan, ever heard of it? Well, it was the terrorist arm of the Democratic Party, according to historians at the University of Tennessee. And in fact, from the end of the Civil War in 1870 to about 1920, if you look at records and research from the Tuskegee Institute, lynchings in America exploded right at the height of the Ku Klux Klan's power. You see, they, historians say, were used to terrorize black and white Republicans to keep them from voting Republican or running for office as Republicans. It was President Woodrow Wilson who resegregated the federal government in 1913. So Ulysses S. Grant, former president, great military leader, desegregated the federal government. He also desegregated the United States military. Woodrow Wilson said, this guy was the worst. He resegregated the US military and the federal government. It wasn't until 2020 that Princeton University realized that they probably should not have Woodrow Wilson's name all over their buildings. Princeton University, which I hear is hard to get into, Ivy League school. They were smart enough to be so smart that they were also dumb enough to not know that they had a virulent racist all over their buildings and halls. I don't know. I don't get it. From one racist president to another, Franklin Delano Roosevelt. You know him. He's like overhyped. That's what he is. His housing administration actually... his New Deal actually set up a housing administration that pushed policies that denied loans in black neighborhoods, a practice now known as redlining. Now, the aforementioned Pete Buttigieg talks about racist bridges and roads, and Senator Pocahontas up in Massachusetts has talked about redlining for years, but neither of them actually talk about Franklin Delano Roosevelt's New Deal and the housing administration that actually codified discrimination throughout the country for decades. It's some legacy. Now, many of you might be asking how the Democratic Party was actually able to sustain so much racial terror for so many years. Well, they actually had something called white-only primaries. Up until 1944, when a far less racist Supreme Court overturned that. But it was not until the 1970s that a black person was elected to Congress because of the Democrats' white-only primaries. You had the first Republican woman, Jeanette Lankin from Montana, obviously Claire Booth Luce, Mae Nolan, all women serving in Congress in 1910, 30, and 40, but you didn't have any black Democrats because of these white-only primaries. All of the first black Republicans in Congress were there in 1870. Hiram Revels from South Carolina, just above Savannah, where I was born and raised. This all brings us back to Alyssa Milano, of course, and her ridiculously stupid Twitter thread about all the great things that the Democratic Party has done that she would like us to believe started in 1920. It was Woodrow Wilson who was in office when the 19th Amendment was ratified, yes. But, and I have it here from the Democrats.org website, quote, under the leadership of Democratic President Woodrow Wilson, the United States Constitution was amended to grant women the right to vote, end quote. There's just one problem. Yes, according to Margaret Susan Thompson, who is a professor of history at the Syracuse University, and I'm quoting her, Democrat, the GOP supported women's suffrage first. That's right. Democrats fought for decades to not allow women the right to vote. So they were racist and sexist a long time ago. And their website also did mention that. Today, although the Democratic Party obviously has changed in some obvious and strange ways, it is still the party of unfettered abortion, which ends black life in America, in the womb, sadly, every single day. The Democratic Party is still the party of disarming Americans, which too oftentimes comes down to taking guns and gun rights away from people who look like me, disallowing me the ability to protect myself and my family and my business. And too oftentimes, these individuals live in cities run by Democrats that have been turned into killing fields and crime-ridden hellholes. The Democratic Party is still the party of open borders, where the Civil Rights Commission has been telling us for decades that if you have unfettered amounts of illegal aliens coming into the country, employers trying to compete with other employers will hire these people, which makes it that much harder for blue collar and high school educated whites and black Americans to actually get a job. Because if the employer can pay this illegal alien pennies on the dollar, he's not going to hire and pay an American born citizen. That is the Democratic Party today. Now today, the Democratic Party's president, Joe Biden, and the Biden crime family, as one of the greatest YAF members, Peter Schweitzer, calls them, because of his investigative research, we know that the Biden family has made money to the tune of millions of dollars with the Chinese communist regime, the biggest slaver on the planet. Now, this should come as no surprise to anyone who knows anything about Joe Biden, because it was just a few years ago that he actually stopped bragging about working with segregationist Senate Democrats in the Senate. In fact, it took his current Vice President Kamala Harris to basically call him a bigot on the debate stage before old Joe got the memo. I say all this to say to you that as you go on and graduate high school and you find yourselves on these college campuses, do not for a second allow yourself to be consigned to be lectured by a bunch of purple-haired freaks on equity and racial inclusion, those same clowns who very likely support this very same Democratic Party that presided over 150 years of racial brutality in this country. To hell with that. Don't let it happen. Young America's Foundation is an absolutely amazing organization that, as Kyle said, will give you the tools that you will need to push back on these clowns and freaks, some of them your peers and some of them, sadly, your professors. Take it from me. I feel so old, but it was about 15 years ago that I was sitting right where you're sitting right now. It was 2009, the college conference was my first conference. I remember it like it was yesterday. We didn't know what to call it then, but I basically took a selfie with Mike Pence, who was number three in Congress at that time. It changed my life forever. I remember talking to Ron Robinson for about an hour, and I couldn't understand why this apparently important person in this organization would spend that much time with my ignorant little self, but he did. And Patrick Coyle showed me so much compassion. And my journey to YAF was probably a little bit different from yours, but it started right on the college campus. If I hadn't made a series of decisions that landed me in Winton Hall, another great YAF member, his office, I probably wouldn't be sitting here today. So let me give you a little bit of advice, okay? Number one, read and support conservative media like Breitbart.com and others. Number two, find and support each other on social media. big each other up, have each other's backs. Number three, arm yourselves with the intellectual arrows that you will need when you find yourselves in debates with professors or your peers. But I will tell you that some of these people struggle to put two brain cells together. It really won't be that hard. Here's a bonus one. Don't download TikTok. Joe Biden's finally getting around to it, but just stay away from that one. It's Chinese communist mind control. And always remember the famous words of Frederick Douglass: those who make it easy to be whipped will be whipped most. So don't be whipped. Stay strong and fight for the country that you so obviously love. Thank you, and God bless you, and may God keep you in all of your endeavors.
We have time for a few questions. If you would like to ask a question, please go ahead and line up with my colleague Jamie back there.
Don't be shy. Just no dating advice questions. I'm terrible at that.
Hi, I'm Sarah. I'm from Buchanan High School. And my question for you is, how are we supposed to find other conservatives on social media when the very algorithm is working against us? And should we also connect with some of the more centrist liberal people who do admit that and support some of conservative viewpoints and like have them back us up on some of our points so people will listen more?
Yeah, absolutely. No, I mean, I'll take the second part of the question first. I have hundreds of books in my bookshelf back in Jacksonville, Florida. And about half of them are from liberal or left-wing authors, media members, professors, thinkers. You want to, as I said, inform yourself and be able to speak the language of the left. I see a lot of people, I have friends who are like Bernie Sanders supporters or former Bernie Sanders supporters, because, you know, just through conversation, they realize that the guy talks the talk but doesn't walk the walk. The same for Elizabeth Warren. I mean, she basically lied about her heritage for years to advance her career. But you need to be able to know these things and just, you know, ease it into the conversation with them. As far as finding like-minded people like yourself, I know the scourge of the tech lords. Please don't get me started. I'm about to short circuit. It is evil. It's terrible. But that is why YAF exists. I mean, you can outsmart the algorithm, okay? This isn't Terminator 2. We can beat Skynet here. I mean, you can just search hashtags and weed out the people trolling, but certainly find the sincere people who are actually doing great work in activism on social media. It's what I used to do before I stopped tweeting all the time. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Pablo Vieira. So what was one of the big reasons why you started your YAP chapter and why it has affected your life today?
I didn't start a YAP chapter at Florida State. It was already there by the time I got there, thankfully. I'll tell you, Winton Hall, a YAF board member, I believe. Maybe I gave him a promotion, I don't know. I said it in a way. I made a series of decisions that landed me at Bainbridge College. I just basically didn't know what I wanted to do with my life at 20, which a lot of 20-year-olds. And I was in his class, and I remember walking into his office, and on his desk he had a photo of Frederick Douglass and Martin Luther King. And it was cognitive dissonance, which I didn't know what that was at the time, because Winton was just a handsome white guy with these two black civil rights heroes on his desk. But we developed a friendship, you know, that went beyond him being my professor, and that led to me writing the article, The Life of a Young Black Conservative, which, you know, Glenn Beck graciously put on his website. That, Pablo, was the first time that I realized that I have the ability through written word to inspire what became thousands of people sending me messages on Facebook when I got out of class at Tallahassee Community College one day. I couldn't believe it. I thought I'd done something wrong. But those people were thanking me for telling my story. I basically went to a Christmas party and was beat to hell for having, oh, not physically, but, you know, I was castigated for having the wrong opinions. I couldn't even spell Condoleezza Rice, but I was defending every decision she made. And I wrote about it, honestly. And I talked about a little bit of the history of the Democratic Party. Why in the hell would I ever support a party that has brutalized people who look like me from the existence of the party's founding? And, you know, I found Andrew Breitbart, and the man was a giant in so many ways. And he talked, not even really in terms of party, and the way he wrote about changing culture and how you have to change culture before you can affect politics. It was mesmerizing to me. And, you know, like I said, I changed my degree at Florida State 5 times, and I finally figured it out. And I know you will too. And it will be so fun, trust me. And in like 15 years, I aged 20 years over the last 24 hours. You know, it'll be you behind this lectern speaking. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Carson from Legacy Christian Academy. So with the left controlling the media, search engines, Wikipedia, social media, how can we as conservatives best share the facts about the Democrat Party and other relevant facts without being shut down or the facts being hidden or misled?
You know, it used to be sort of funny to say, you know, just build your own platform, but you literally can do that now. I mean, I built my own website on Weebly 15 years ago. I didn't know what the hell I was doing, but, you know, it wasn't that hard. I don't know how to explain blockchain, but apparently it's important in doing this. No, seriously, I mean, at Breitbart News, we have an Instagram account dedicated to something that we started a little over 2 years ago called Be Inspired News. And it's got 6-figure followers. We don't put any money behind it. And it really is just news clippings of what it is. It's inspiring good stories about brave first responders and good Samaritans and neighbors. It was just an idea. Like, and that's usually how this stuff starts. We share it on social media, and we have to use the evil Mark Zuckerberg and their platforms for now. But I mean, you see, you know, all kinds of social media platforms propping up all over the place. But I don't know. I feel like the best way I've affected people's lives is really through written word. I mean, the left can't shut down the internet. You know, although Google might try. I don't know. But, you know, face-to-face conversations, I mean, that's where I've seen it hundreds of times on campuses with YAF. I mean, setting up the booth and having, you know, attention-grabbing, a little bit provocative literature and fixtures, but people coming up and gaining their interest that way. You know, look, as I was telling Kyle, the further away I get from where I used to work for Peter Schweitzer at the Government Accountability Institute, which saw me spending 10 hours a day researching corruption in the federal government, I used to be a huge cynic, basically. And the further away I get from that job, the more optimistic I am. The media does kind of control. It's like an iron triangle, the media, the entertainment space, and politics. And they're still losing in many ways. I mean, that's encouraging. It should be encouraging to you. I mean, use their platforms to beat them. We use their words against them all the time. I don't see how the other can't be different.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, I'm Gavin Fisher. I'm from Grace Brethren High School.
Hi, Gavin.
And I was wondering, at what point do you think that the Democratic Party kind of shifted from appealing to black people and minority, or sorry, appealing to kind of racists to trying to appeal to black people and minorities more?
Yeah, you know, I don't know, boy. Kyle said coon earlier. I don't know. It's a bit. Lyndon Johnson. It's really hard to get in the most virulent racist president club. There are a lot of them. Lyndon Johnson's probably on the Rushmore. Barack Obama admitted it at a ceremony for his library. Every president shouldn't get a library, by the way. LBJ doesn't deserve one. Anyway, it is said that after signing the Civil Rights legislation, 1964, Civil Rights Act, 65, Lyndon Johnson, by the way, as a congressman in Texas, fought against every piece of legislation. But he was president when it passed. It was said that on a plane talking to the then governor of Georgia, that Lyndon Johnson was asked why he supported civil rights legislation. He didn't do it because he wanted to bring the country together along racial lines. It is said that he told that reporter, because we, the Democrats, will have them niggas voting for 200 years, Democrat for 200 years. The great, late great Rush Limbaugh said this, he sort of made this point just before he passed away, is it's hard to beat Santa Claus. And I think, you know, that is kind of what FDR knew. It's like, oh, we'll just start a whole bunch of programs and we'll get people hooked on it. I mean, poverty in America was dropping. I write about this in my first book for 2 decades before Lyndon Johnson's Great Society programs were even initiated. But you look at what unfettered welfare has done. We have spent $25 trillion on the war on poverty, and poverty won. I don't even think along racial lines that is what these Democrats and these liberals were thinking about then. I just think they looked at people as playthings that they could self and social engineer to win elections, and now self-enrich.
Hello, my name is Austin. I am homeschooled. Thank you for being here. I was wondering, because earlier you said you started attending YAF conferences in college, mm-hmm. and I was wondering when you became a conservative.
Yeah, no, it wasn't the day I walked into Winton's office, but you know, I encourage you to find a professor or several professors who you don't have to agree with them on everything, but who encourage you. I used to say this all the time, and then I stopped because I realized I was saying it on camera, and I didn't want one of those montages to be made of me saying the same thing on camera. But my campus in, you know, 2009, 10, 11, you know, sadly looked a lot like campuses look today. And I realized that my peers were, you know, not being encouraged to think critically, but sort of taught to be skeptical of those who tried to. And, you know, I love people who are Democrats. And a lot of them are former Democrats because of the relationship that they have with me. I'm not saying if you're a Democrat or you're a liberal that you're bound for hell. No, it's a lie. You know, you believe it based on a lie. They hide it on their own freaking website. But Winton just looked at me like an individual. He saw in me, you know, at 20s, you know, just potential that I didn't see in myself. And he started giving me books from his library. He even had it embroidered, the library of Winton Hall. I got like 100 of them in my library now. But he would give me these books, Thomas Sowell and, you know, Friedman, Hayek. It taught me about the history of the country. I had a great education in Chatham County in Savannah, but they missed a lot in the curriculum. And with the education grew an appreciation for this country that I did not have previously. And I'm not unique in that way. You know, I met countless people who, you know, passed through those different levels of enlightenment politically and philosophically. But history is sort of littered with that type of actualization. When Muhammad Ali fought George Foreman in Zaire in the mid-70s, after his victory, a reporter walked up to Muhammad Ali and said, "This is your first time to Africa, champ. What did you think?" And he said, "I'm glad my daddy got on that boat." Now, that was Muhammad Ali. He didn't really mince words. But what he was saying was, he is glad that, you know, he didn't live in Africa, because in the 70s at that time, particularly in Zaire, it was abject poverty. And that is what I saw on the left, poverty. Not economically in many ways, but I saw family members, and I still have them, God bless them, who are trapped in a cycle of poverty of the soul. And that is what liberalism and the democratic policies that FDR and Lyndon Johnson pushed. Again, I don't think they cared about the race of the people, although LBJ didn't bite his tongue about it. They just did it for power. I hope I answered your question.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay.
My name is Lauren Petrosky from Amherst Academy. Lauren. I was wondering, what was your favorite YAF conference in college?
Well, nothing could beat the 2009 conference. Again, another joke that I stopped saying that I'll repeat here. That montage is coming. Daniel J. Flynn wrote an amazing book called The Conservative History of the American Left. And YAF, as Kyle and I have discussed, used to have an essay competition. I don't know if they still have it. And I entered it on the idea that if you won, you would, you know, be sent up to DC for the student conference. I entered the contest. I don't know if I won or if I placed, but I found myself at that conference. And it was absolutely life-changing for me because, you know, I don't know. My dad's used to talk about how he loved voting for Nixon, but you know, I didn't exactly grow up in a conservative household. And so for me, it was the first time that I was actually in a room with young conservatives cracking jokes and pointing out dumb liberal ideas and laughing at them. And it changed my life forever. Coming back to speak to you fine people, it does rival that moment for me. Because as I was telling Kyle, it just feels like magic to me. Like it took 15 years before I could actually understand and appreciate, you know, just the mathematics that got me at that conference. And YAF does it every day, every week, every month. So I don't know. I mean, treasure these moments. If I'm saying anything, take it from the old guy.
Hello, I'm Nino Palumbo.
I know you, Nino.
Yeah. And as you know, I'm from Washington, D.C., and I go to the high school. So I wanted to ask you, but first, a little bit of background. So I myself used to be a very hard, like stubborn liberal.
And same. Now
I have changed conservative with you guys joining a YAF and whatnot. So I have family members and friends who might as well be stubborn as well. So I was wondering, what advice would you give to kind of let them see the light of conservatism?
Well, I would have them purchase two books, 50 Things They Don't Want You to Know and 50 Things They Don't Want You to Know About Trump. No, in my first book, I wrote that book for one audience. I knew that people who appreciated my writing, for whatever reason, would support the book. But I sat down every day for about a year researching and writing that book for who you used to be, and who I used to be, and who Andrew Breitbart used to be, and Joel Pollack, who ran for Congress in Chicago, for crying out loud. for people who don't agree with me, and you know, I cover 50 different topics. I cover crime, immigration, homelessness, you know, green energy, and it is some of the most honest writing that I think I'll ever be able to do, because 90% of authors never get to write a second book. So I was like, well, this is my one shot. I'm gonna give it my all. And I think that is, I found that's the best way to, you know, change someone's mind or open them up to the idea that, you know, the political philosophy that they've had probably their entire lives, and it was passed down to them by their parents who got it from their parents, may not be the whole truth. It may not be the whole story. And I've found that, I mean, you know, because, you know, politics for some people can be religion. It can be sacrosanct to say the wrong thing. Trust me, you know, read my article. It's brutal, and it can be. But I've always believed that sooner or later, we humans are self-interested, and we want to be free. We yearn for it. It's a part of our preternatural, you know, survival system. And the left has gone absolutely crazy. I mean, our border is an absolute disgrace to mankind, what is happening. And the most evil regime in China is somehow pushing deadly drugs from that country through our border. It's enriching mass murdering cartels. And our president won't even go down there. He'd do the photo op. But that sad reality is pressing up against a lot of people's lives more and more. It's awful that things are getting so bad for people to realize it, but that does, in a way, make it easier for you to have those conversations.
Thank you.